is Dr. Ajay Parida. We had him as a chairman yesterday as well. As you all know, he is the executive director, M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, Chennai. The rapporteur will be Dr. B. Narayan Swami. He was earlier the head of KVK, an IIHR KVK, that is Indian Institute of Horticultural Research, Krishi Vignan Kendra, located at Gonikoppal in Koor district of Karnataka. And he is at present senior scientist, an extension worker with vast experience in the division of extension in IIHR Bangalore. Over to you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I think we are on to the next session of the exciting presentations. Look forward to listening to, I think there is a slight change, there is four presentations now, and we'll be having Dr. C.L.L. Gowda, Dr. R.S.S. Hopper, Dr. A.K. Handa and Dr. Anill Prakash Joshi before the lunch time. And all of you know that the lunch will start at 1:30. So we have a tight schedule. My only request to all the speakers to restrict it to 20 minutes or 25 minutes of presentation, followed by some discussion. Well, I think the first speaker is Dr. C.L.L. Gowda. He is the one of the leading pulse science researchers in at the international level, and he is the research program director at the International Crop Research Institute for Semi-Arid Tropics, which is one of the CGIAR institutions. And he is going to speak on enhancing the productivity and production of pulses in India,
yeah,
a topic which is of very importance to the in the national scenario. Dr. Gowda, please.
Thank you, Dr. Parida, for that introduction. Not at good afternoon, so maybe by the time I finish, it will be afternoon, so don't think that I've taken long time between morning and afternoon, but I'll try to make it within the time allocated. If you see yesterday, presentations were on individual crops. Rice, wheat, but today it is pulses. And I will show you later on, it's not going to be an easy task to cover so many pulses, but I will try to drill down to a few examples only, so that I will give them as case studies and just indicate that other things are possible looking at some of these success stories and case studies. Just to indicate, pulses are not just pulses for the sake of pulses. They have a lot of role in human health, being major sources of protein for the large vegetarian population that is there, mostly in South Asia, but also in many parts of the world. They also not only have high protein, but they complement the cereals, rice, wheat, or any other cereal like ragi or bajra, with other essential amino acids, vitamins, and minerals, which are lacking in the cereals, but they get complemented when people take pulses along with that. They are known to reduce a lot of what we call non-communicable diseases, the NCDs that I've indicated. I've just given a few examples, but there are many other such non-communicable diseases that the pulses have capability to reduce or get them to a level that is more reasonable. One of the advantages of pulses is they can be cultivated on a range of soils, range of climates and cropping systems. It's a good thing, but also on the other side, not so good thing, because people just think that they are pulses, so you just throw, come back and harvest. And that is why, one of the reasons why many pulses are reported to be yielding less, because farmers consider them as secondary or even sometimes tertiary crops, not giving enough attention. But they have the capacity to fix atmospheric nitrogen through the rhizobium aided nitrogen fixation, and many of them have capacity to release soil-bound phosphorus and make them available not only for their own but also for other companion crops, and thereby contribute significantly to the sustainability of the farming systems. People talked about malnutrition. This is just a slide that I thought I will give. There is one more, another slide which gives, this is the total population in millions. As you can see, among all the continents, including people say Africa is very poor, look at the malnutrition level in sub-Saharan Africa. This is absolute numbers, but look at the percentages also compared to South Asia, which is very high. Look at the percentages in India. In this particular case, in 2004-06, it is less than 40, but yesterday the Prime Minister's report said it is 42% of malnutrition in India. This is South Asia. So malnutrition is high, and pulses have a big role to improve or reduce this malnutrition. Because improve means it can be interpreted in many other ways. So I said reduce malnutrition. There are many challenges, because currently the per capita consumption of pulses is very less. This is mostly because in India we don't produce enough pulses, that because of the high population and demand. There is also limited global supply, so we cannot also import a lot of it. And again indicated the incidence of non-communicable diseases. And one of the reasons why pulses are less available in India is because pulses have been displaced from their original place of cultivation by other remunerative crops, the so-called remunerative crops, because of the Green Revolution that most people are proud of, and also was getting mentioned yesterday and even today. But that is one of the reasons why we have less pulses, because more area is being allocated to rice, wheat, and other cereals. Also, increased cost of cultivation, especially the labor costs, are making it less remunerative. I just said there are lots of pulses, more than 26 pulses cultivated around the world. I just listed only a few that are cultivated to a large extent in India. When I go to a few more slides, I will tell you which are the major ones in India. But in India, these are the pulses that are grown, and we can now realize why I said this is not an easy topic to cover, that people made on single crops. In terms of the scenario of pulses in India, India, despite all things, is the largest producer of pulses and also the largest consumer of pulses. Still, we import about 3.5 million tons in 2009-10, 11-12, because we had record production. The importation was less, but still we need to import quite a lot, especially from Myanmar, Canada, Australia, Turkey, Mexico, and Iran. Pulses cultivated in both the seasons, both in Kharif, the rainy season, and the post-rainy or the Rabi season. And the following are the major ones, important ones that are cultivated in India: chickpea, Bengal gram or chana, pigeon pea, tur, arhar or red gram, mung bean and urd bean, and lentil. These are the five major pulses grown in India. The demand currently is about 20 to 21 million tons. When the population of India currently from 1.2, it goes to 1.68 billion in 2030, we will need about 32 million tons of pulses with an anticipated growth rate of 4.2%. Current growth rate is about 1.7%. So there is a huge demand. But as I will show you later, India can, it has the capacity and it can produce the needed pulses, provided we have the will and we can have the necessary strategies to meet that projected demand. This is just a graph to show that over the 60-year period, the area and production have increased. But more importantly, look at that green graph there. That is the yield per hectare. The productivity has jumped quite significantly in the last few years, indicating that the scientists have been successful in developing varieties that have given more yield per hectare. This is what I was mentioning: displacement of the pulses from their traditional areas of cultivation. See the top, look at the bottom first. In 1971-75, just around the Green Revolution period, the total area in northwest India was just around 11 million hectares. By 2006-10, it had come down to 8 million. But fortunately, Central and South India has taken over this reduction in North India and has been able to compensate to some extent. But mind you, the growing situations in Central and South India are not as congenial as they are in North India. So the yields have been slightly less, but the scientists have developed varieties that are adapted to these climatic conditions and still have been able to produce enough, although not as much enough not to have imports, but definitely good enough to survive. There are many constraints. Many people in other crops also indicated constraints to production. I'm just giving you a few so that you have a feel of what are the major ones. In terms of biotic stresses, that is the biological factors, diseases, pests, and in terms of the abiotic or the natural disasters like drought and heat stress, salinity, soil salinity and alkalinity, and more importantly, because the good or the productive soils are being taken over by cereals, the pulses are being relegated to poor, low fertility and problem soils. So that is also one of the major production constraints. In addition to these biotic and abiotic constraints, there are also what we call socio-economic constraints. Mostly I mentioned farmers' perception of the pulses as secondary crops. They don't, it's like a stepmotherly treatment. They consider rice and wheat and other major cereals as important crops. Pulses, okay, throw them in the field. If you get, you get. Otherwise, just don't bother. Limited access of the farmers to inputs, mostly fertilizers, the rhizobium inoculum and others, and more importantly, access to quality seed of improved varieties. Accessibility to markets so that when they have higher produce, they should be able to go and market it and get some profits out of it. And also the post-harvest technologies and value addition so that the farmers can get more out of what they produce. So in terms of the strategies that we can think of, how we can increase the pulse production in India, I've just listed a few, and I will just give one case study and say it is possible in one crop that I am more familiar with, but all I'm saying is it can be done because the technologies are available even for other crops. First and foremost is availability of short duration and high yielding varieties. Scientists, at least the plant breeders and other crop improvement scientists, have been able to develop short duration and high yielding varieties. I said short duration and high yielding because, as I said, from the north where the crop duration is longer, pulses have been shifted to central and peninsular India. So the crop duration is short, so you need shorter duration varieties but still high yielding. We also need varieties with drought tolerance because central and south India, because of higher temperatures, don't have the same amount of soil moisture as you would have in the Indo-Gangetic plain areas. We also have varieties that are adapted to new niches in terms of rice fallows, that is after the harvest of rice, there is still enough moisture in the soil that you can grow a short duration crop of pulses. In the rice wheat system, where instead of growing continuous rice and wheat, you try to take a legume in between, like instead of rice and wheat, take pigeon pea and wheat, where with the availability of short duration varieties, it is possible to do that. Improved seed delivery system. A few speakers yesterday mentioned that our seed production and delivery system is quite good and able to supply. Maybe that statement is good for a few crops like rice, wheat, and other crops. But when it comes to the legumes and other pulses, seed supply is a major problem because of the high volume, low seed viability, transportation problems, and less profitability to the private sector. In other crops where hybrids and small seeded crops, private sector is interested because they get higher profits. But in case of legumes, the private sector is simply not interested because they don't make money out of selling legume seeds. So we need to enhance that particular thing. Improved input supply, not only just fertilizers, but also micronutrients, irrigation. People forget that one irrigation to any of the pulses can increase the yield between 25% to 50%. So instead of giving 5 irrigations to wheat or any other crop, just give one irrigation, you can get an increase of 50% in case of pulses. Mechanization is coming up as a major constraint because labor is becoming expensive and not available. So that is another strategy that we need to have in order to enhance pulse production. So as I said, many crops are there, but I'm just going to take one example with which I'm familiar and say that this is a case study, an example, but there are technologies available and this particular case study can be multiplied even in other crops in other areas. This is a case study from the chickpea success story in Andhra Pradesh. I said Andhra Pradesh because Of course, ICRISAT is located in Andhra Pradesh near Hyderabad. When ICRISAT was established 40 years ago, people said one of the mandate crop was chickpea. Said, how do you have research on chickpea because chickpea cannot be cultivated in Andhra Pradesh? So we had a research station established in Hisar in Haryana to work on chickpea. But over the years, we have been able to develop varieties that are adapted to central and peninsular India, short duration, heat tolerant, and this is the success story of that particular one. As you can see here, during the past 10 years, there has been a fourfold increase in area in Andhra Pradesh, a 2.5 times increase in yield, and mind you, chickpea was not supposed to be a crop adopted to Andhra Pradesh, a 9-fold increase in production, and over 80% of the area under chickpea in Andhra Pradesh is with improved varieties. So from an average yield 10 years ago of about 600 kilograms per hectare in Andhra Pradesh, currently the average yield of chickpea in Andhra Pradesh is 1,400 kilograms per hectare. This is state average. And this is the highest average yield in India. Although I said chickpea yields are higher, were higher in northern India, but this is the average yield in Andhra Pradesh, which 30 years ago people said you cannot profitably cultivate chickpea in Andhra Pradesh. The key factors are these. One is the availability of high yielding, short duration, and heat tolerant, because in central and peninsular India, during the winter season or the rabi season, temperatures are slightly higher. Chickpea is a cool season crop adapted to cooler climates, so we had to breed varieties that were heat tolerant, short duration, and also resistant to that fusarium wilt, which was a major disease. Second factor is the high adoption by the farmers of improved cultivars, but also improved crop production technology. Varieties themselves cannot give high yield. You need to have agronomy that has to go with the variety. And this is what the Andhra farmers did. This is a crop in Andhra Pradesh. Over 80% of the area under chickpea in Andhra Pradesh is under improved varieties. I just mentioned a few of these varieties, and Andhra has also one of the highest seed replacement ratio for chickpea in India, more than 40%. Average is around 20% throughout India. Third is transformation from subsistence agriculture to commercial cultivation of chickpea. What farmers do in Andhra Pradesh is, you see a tractor there spraying chickpea field, and you see the people say that farm size in India is less than 2 hectares. So how do you get that big area for a farmer? A group of 4 or 5 farmers, enterprising farmers, take land and hire around the village, or 2 villages or 3 villages. They take and hire, give the other farmers 5,000 or 6,000 rupees as land rent, and they cultivate using mechanization, and all operations are done using machines, including an improvised spray for managing Helicobacter, which is a major pest. So this shift from subsistence, small-scale cultivation to commercial size cultivation is one of the things that we need to do. As I said, you can't just have a variety, but also have good agronomic practices. On the background, you see the grain storage, the cold storage or storage areas that has been available in many parts of Andhra Pradesh, wherein farmers could avoid distress sale and keep the grain in the storage and sell it when the prices are reasonable or high. Reduce storage losses, and then again, as I said, enable organized marketing and more profitability to the farmers. So if that can succeed in Andhra Pradesh, in India, why not in other crops? As I said, we need to capitalize on the lessons learned. We have all the technologies for all the crops. We need to make adequate investments and efforts in development, adoption of technologies, have the necessary public, private, and people partnerships so that this becomes across all the sectors that are important in development, connect the farmers to the market so that once they produce, they also have a market avenue so that they can make some profits. And most important, there is a need to establish a national pulses board, and not just establish, but have the authority and accountability for the following. Coordinating across all the ministries and departments. So this should go like a mission mode, like it had in earlier cases, like the oilseed mission a few years ago. Coordinate with all the state governments, supply of necessary inputs, monitor the grain procurement, not just announce the minimum support price, but also buy when the produce comes to the market to ensure that the farmers get remunerative prices, not the traders. I think with this, we would be able to have a success in pulse production across India. Thank you.
Time for one or two quick questions or comments. No. I think I have a question.
Yeah.
What did it replace if your chickpea production went for 40% area increase? What did it replace? Which crop did it replace?
In many cases, you know, if you go into coastal Andhra Pradesh around Guntur, it was after rice. So in many cases, it didn't have. But in Kurnool, Anantapur, in some cases, it replaced cotton. In some cases, it replaced safflower. In some of the areas, in some cases, it has replaced rabi jowar. Support from the state government, as also the university, the Andhra Pradesh Seed Development Corporation, and the farmers themselves who came together and formed cooperatives to get the seed distributed.
Thank you.
Yeah, Hindu.
What would your suggestion suggest for increasing the productivity of pulses? What we can do is better. We can go for crop rotation. So basic thing where you can have a yield of your other cereals and pulses also.
That's what you just mentioned. After rice, fallow cultivation model.
Yeah, but that should be increased. Like you can have both together. So it has many positive effects where you can have natural nitrogen fixation.
I think they have taken those factors
into account. As I said, I did not mention all the other areas. I just focused on one particular area, but what you mentioned in terms of intercropping in case of pigeon pea, relay cropping in case of chickpea and lentil after the rice. So those are all the possibilities. When I said new niches and different niches, those are the areas like pigeon pea in some of the hills in Uttarakhand where other crops were not grown, but now because we have a short duration pigeon pea, which can be grown in Uttarakhand, otherwise long duration would get caught by the frost. So we now have possibilities where this can also be grown in those areas. You take Andhra Pradesh itself. Andhra Pradesh is not a chickpea consuming state. Now they are consuming because they are growing, so they consume. But 80% just simply goes to other markets. So people buy in Andhra Pradesh and take it to Bombay market or other markets. So it's just market forces that have found a way of getting access to that. And what I didn't mention is two of the varieties that are there are Kabuli chickpeas. And people said Kabuli chickpea cannot be grown in southern part of India. Now we have large seeded Kabuli varieties and farmers are getting 50 to 60% more price for Kabulis, and that is becoming popular because farmers are getting more price. Same yield. There is no reduction in yield by growing Kabulis.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Gowda.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, I have to cut it, sir, because you have three more presentations. Our next speaker is Dr. Hopper. He is from M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation. And Hopper, you have 20 minutes.
I think it is good afternoon. Respected Chairman and my colleague, Dr. Ajay, rapporteur, distinguished guests, and I see a large number of students. A warm welcome to all of you. This afternoon, I'm just going to share a few thoughts about some of our interesting work, what we are doing at the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation. We are promoting a very different kind of a project, what is called as Bio-Industrial Watersheds, which really addresses the issues of small and marginal farmers, and also in correlation with the theme which we have for this conference about how do you look at small farm productivity, especially looking into the future we want to really be. M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation's vision is to harness science and technology for sustainable and equitable development. We work in six states with 21 field locations. But the whole gamut of how we operate is through a pro-poor, pro-nature, pro-women and pro-sustainable livelihood orientation to both technology development as well as dissemination. This is what the M.S. Swaminathan Foundation is. We're looking into how we harness science and technology for human development. Today, if you look around, that the question is that how can today agriculture and water become part of the conservation solution and not a problem? Given this key nexus which all of us have been talking for the last, from yesterday onwards, about agriculture, water, and climate change, the reinforcing factors together, looking at issues of food security. So now the whole dependence is all about rain-fed agriculture, which is still an untapped potential today in our country. And this whole watershed program, what I'll be talking to you about, is based on rain-fed agriculture system. So what do we mean by this bio-industrial watershed? In fact, when I always discuss with many of our friends across NGOs, across governments and others, they ask me, what is this new concept called bio-industrial watershed? This approach builds on the conventional system of watershed, what many of them are really doing. But here the difference is that we are looking into scaling up with value additions and new markets. And that is the buzzword today. We need to look at value addition. Many of our speakers, we're talking about value additions. And we also want to look at new markets. We look at new products, we want to look at new markets. And what is very important is that the whole thing is supported through an institutional system, which is co-owned and managed by the watershed communities in different agroecological systems in the country. This is the framework in which we operate. We have basically three major components in the center, as you see, looking into conservation enhancement of natural resources, land, water, and biodiversity, which is very important. The center one is very important, improving small farm productivity and profitability, looking into the process of participatory technology development and integrated farming system. Not to forget the whole crop livestock integration along with the NRM system. And lastly, a great challenge today for many of us working in the field of agriculture and allied is promoting non-farm market-driven enterprises. And finally, looking into the whole institutional aspect of how do we promote bio-industrial institutions. This project is a pilot project which we've been doing for the last 5 years from 2007 onwards, supported by the JRD Tata Trust. We work in various agricultural regions, both in Tamil Nadu, we work in Orissa, we also work in Punjab and Madhya Pradesh. We do work with partners, and here we have a partnership approach with the agriculture universities as well as with the NGOs in Punjab as well as in Madhya Pradesh. The whole approach, if you look at, is holistic as well as human-centered, and that is what plays a key factor. We're looking into a convergence mode where we look at various stakeholders coming together, looking at for collective action. Capacity building is another important thing, looking into knowledge management. And looking into a consortium of technical support backstopping, which we have, which gives us the technical as well as the guidance of this. And above all, the very important thing, especially looking into delivery systems, is looking into commitment as well as ABC, that is attitudinal behavior change of the communities as well as the stakeholders with whom we are really working. What we've done before is that before we started this whole program is that we have done a participatory disaggregated matrix based on gender and land holdings. So you can see from the slide on the other side, one side we have the various interventions. And who are the basic actors who are going to be benefited in this whole program? These are the various participants. At the MS Swaminathan Research Foundation, we have a clear policy of not to use this word beneficiary. We call them as partners, we call them as participants with whom we're going to work with. Because beneficiaries are we who basically are going to really benefit. So if you look across, you find that most of them are small and marginal farmers looking into the various kinds of on-farm interventions which we have proposed. As well as the off-farm enterprises, we also have a big challenge to work with landless agriculture labor women. If you look at our program across the various sites, if you look at our, some of our significant achievements, I'm not going deep into it, it's already available in my paper. But some of the nice things which has happened is that we have had assured irrigation for the first crop, where many of them were still uncertain about how to grow the crop in rain-fed systems. We also were able to have an additional crop cycle, and here we're looking into the possibilities of growing pulses and also some of the black gram, green gram varieties. We're able to reclaim a large amount of fallow lands. And what is on the social side is that it has promoted confidence, ownership, and participation among the farmers. And I said earlier that grassroots instrument building is one of the key things supporting this whole program. Replication sustainability is also another key additive factor in this whole process. Working with stakeholders, we managed to leverage nearly about 3 crores of rupees to really carry out a number of soil and water conservation measures. Coming to the on-farm, through the value chain process, we have managed some of our achievements, what we have been working. And looking into off-farm technology, which is also related, and today that is very much needed. You can't just work only on-farm, but you also need to look at locally adapted on-farm technologies, mainly addressing issues of small and marginal farmers. We have mapped the entire villages, especially the communities, and we came across a unique situation of difficult months where many of the lower status of the community are basically hungry. Many of them can't afford to have jobs during that time, and that is where most of our interventions are really going to work. We've looked at forward and backward linkages to strengthen most of our off-farm enterprises. And finally, as I talked about, that we're looking into a whole system of value chain analysis. But the key challenge this morning is also looking at small and marginal farmers. How do we link on and off-farm livelihoods and food security together? We have identified a number of biological softwares which promote sustainable agriculture. And this picture gives you a wide variety of programs with whom we really work with. Very important is the underlying or the base or on which the whole thing is going to really happen is the entire social mobilization process. We have promoted a number of grassroots institutions. Now they're all being transformed into farmers, producer companies, women's federations. We have identified role models or agents of change. And the whole program revolves on the knowledge management system. We have a number of trainee days we have. We have promoted literacy movements and programs for water, climate change adaptations and entitlements, which has benefited some of them. But a key thing in this whole process is that how do you look at lab-to-land kind of integration? Looking into land-to-lab, you need to have both ways you need to look at. And very important also from land-to-land. This is mainly looking into peer group kind of a learning process. And finally, also across scientific institutions of lab-to-lab. I'll just this morning take you across a few best practices or good practices and models which we have been quite successful in this program, which will also give us a sense of how is the challenge you're going to meet on these small and marginal farmers. These best practices has given us an opportunity for innovations as well as integrations. And also it has promoted a platform, or it has formed platforms for us for sharing as well as spreading to sustain our programs. As I told you that we work on a very major program on participatory technology development. This has been one of our major processes when we work with on-farm research, which is farmer-led. And these are some of the ways in which you go about participatory technology development. through farmers field schools, through TOTs, through farmers field days and all. But very important is that prioritizing problems, working jointly for solutions, looking at participatory monitoring system is the key word. We look at participatory technology development. A very interesting thing what we've done in this program is that how do you look at usufruct systems of common lands? I think we've been talking from yesterday, but not many speakers have really looked at this aspect of common lands, especially looking at water bodies, looking at lands wherein the poor, small and marginal farmers can have access to them. Here we had a very interesting program we had. We had 23 families who basically have leased a land from the panchayat. Through the Agriculture Engineering Department scheme, we have excavated the whole land. And it is these families who are basically Dalit, small and marginal farmers who basically have designed this entire integrated farm pond. They have done it. And here we find that they've also built an embankment for them for the flood water not to go inside. And you find that they're able to reap better harvest. They're able to get vegetables from the farm pond. They're able to get fishes from the farm pond. They're able to get fodder for the cattle. So these are the kinds of integration which has really happened in this program. And what is very important was that they were using drinking water which the government was supplying for washing their utensils and clothes and all. But now they have stopped it and started using the farm pond for many of their domestic uses. The government has now taken this program and they started replicating this across many of their programs, mainly trying to see how when farm ponds are given as a scheme, how we could bring in an integration system into these kind of things. We have also promoted as an integrated system, we have done a number of models on integrated intensive farming system models. You can see the pictures about how we have gone about various kinds of these kind of IFS models. Reclaiming fallow land, especially in rainfall agriculture system, is a very important challenge. We're looking into dryland horticulture as an on-farm livelihood and also an option for climate change adaptation. So here we have a picture showing about nearly about 16 Dalit farmers. They're all small and marginal farmers who own 20 acres of leased land. All these years, these leased lands were basically fallow. They had nothing else to do. So when we had our discussion with them through participatory approaches, we had a number of discussions, and with the help of our stakeholders with whom we work, we managed to convert these 20 acres now into a dryland horticulture model. We've also managed to get support from a corporate sector to put up a well, and the entire community has also contributed towards this kind of thing. It's not just a grant which is given to them, but mainly through community participation, contribution, as well as ownership. But the innovation which has come into this and the integration is that we have integrated the livestock, the fodder grass, pulses as intercrops, bun plantation, all these things has also come into this whole dryland horticulture system. But there are challenges. Challenges are leasing the land for the panchayat is not that easy. These are the lands which they had very difficult and finally they got the patta. And finally it was a new experience for them, just fallow dry lands which they see every day, but it's a new experience for them to rehabilitate the land. Learning and working together is very important. How do you now look at cooperation? How do they work together, coordination and conflict resolution? This is another model which we are now promoting in Orissa among the tribal farmers, wherein we have these small dug wells, which is low cost, which hardly costs about 12,000 rupees, and how these tribal communities are able now to use it as a model to irrigate their lands to promote small nutrition gardens. We just start off with two demonstration wells, as you see in point number four. And today we have more than 58 dug wells we have benefiting about 185 households. But now the panchayat, the government has also now come forward to see that can we take this up to other panchayats as well as also to other villages to see how they could use it now for their domestic needs as well as for their agriculture needs. The challenge today is that we're looking at the whole livelihood system, especially for smaller marginal farmers and landless urbanists. How do we demystify technologies? Our friend from the FAO this morning also did talk about how do we demystify technologies. And if you want to demystify technologies, there are four important things. We need to identify the right technology through baseline surveys, as well as trying to look at various institutes where you can get the right technology. Internalization is going to play a very major part, and this is where the role of scientists comes. That, for example, now when we work with mushroom production, technologies are available in the agriculture universities, available in the KVKs research institutes. But how do you bring this technology down to a particular socio-economic condition is very, very important. Innovation integration plays a very important part to increase the effectiveness and efficiency. And finally, the involvement of adaption and adoption by the people is very important. Value addition is another important part which you look at looking to natural resources. We have some of our women, especially small and marginal farm women who have got small plantations and how they can now value add using natural fibers. This is a photograph shown a small paper mill run by a women's self-help group. M.S. Swamirathan Foundation is known for its work on bridging the digital divide. We are one of the leaders in the country working on knowledge management, looking into the whole village knowledge centers. In all the seven states, in all our programs, this is the cross-cutting issues of promoting village resource centers, which will be the hub, as well as village knowledge centers. But what is very important is how do we now today effectively bring about connecting people to people and finally people to information, and getting information at the right time is the key thing. But what many of them are really worried is that is it capital intensive or not? But our experience says that it has not been that capital intensive, but more of a knowledge intensive program. This is a model which we have now implementing in all the seven states. This is the hub and spoke model. The village resource center is the hub, and we have all the village knowledge centers around the hub. And we are trying to see that how we could go about disseminating information through text messages, voice messages. We have newspapers. And now you can see that we also have a major program working with the fishermen community. Using fishermen are using these mobiles to know about the wavelength, the tide, and other things. From the whole information system, we now move towards climate change. We also have a very major program on climate change adaptation we have. This is through the whole knowledge agriculture using ICT tools. In all our project villages, wherever we're working on rainfall systems, we do have locally in the village-based, we have small agronomy stations we have. Here is a photograph of an agronomy station you can see. You can see how the communities are being trained on how to monitor the wind speed, the temperature, as well as the rainfall data are being monitored. So this is one of our major programs. And we've also now trained some of the community members, what we call them as climate risk managers. So these are the both youth, as well as some of the smaller marginal farm men and women who have been trained to see how they can go about bringing an literacy among the community on various issues of climate change adaptation. Farmers in our program have also developed various thumb rules of how do you go about interpreting some of the data, what we get from these agromet stations. You can see rainfall, what do they do, for wind speed, what do they do, as well as looking into temperature. So farmers have developed their own participatory mechanism of how do they address issues of climate change adaptation. Dr. Gowda did talk about the pulses. We both are also partners of a major program looking into climate change on the Indo-Morocco Food Legume Initiative. This is a new program which we just initiated together with ICRISAT, with ICARDA, as well as the MS Swaminathan Foundation, with a corporate company in Morocco, which is called the OCP Foundation. Our whole program is we're trying to see how we could bring about climate smart, improved technologies and governance among various farming groups. We are working on mainly on pulses, promoting pulses, especially in a watershed context. We have developed a number of monitoring systems with the help of the National Pulses Research Center. You can see some of our farm women, how they are interacting. And with the participant approach, I said through the PDD process that it is the communities and the scientists who are going to jointly really evaluate this whole program. So here you can see through a scorecard of red, blue, and green, how do they score the participatory varietal selection trials. This is a model. Gowda did talk about the public-private partnership. This is a model what we're going to work on promoting pulse villages. So our challenge is that in all these watershed villages, we're trying to see that how do you bring about pulse villages. And very important is going to be an aspect is how do you bring about seed production. That's what Dr. Parida did ask a question about seed production. And seed production is going to play a very major part of availability of the right seeds in the right time. We do have another major program on climate change we have, that is with the ICR. It is called the NICRA program. If you want much information, you can always get it from the website of NICRA, from CREDA. This is a major program initiated in the country today. We have nearly about 100 KVKs are involved in this with modern agro stations they have. Plus, we do have a lot of research, ICR Research Institute who are partners in this program. This is also here we're focusing our whole attention towards smaller marginal farmers to see how they could now cope up with this whole area of climate change adaptation. The last model, what you're talking about, basically looking at the entire area of participatory integrated value chain analysis. In all our watershed sites, we have identified the major crops which could now be studied for value chain analysis, which could now be analyzed with the farmers, and how we could now bring them into the farmers' institutional system. Scaling up is going to play a very key part for us in these 5+ years, what we're now looking into, strengthening our forward and backward linkages. And what is very important is trying to bridge, sustain, and increase the yield gap. That is what is going to be our buzzword in this whole on-farm productive and profitable system. And social production mechanism is a key challenge for us. We are still struggling with the whole weather-based insurance system. It is easily said that we need to access weather-based system, weather-based insurance system, but it's a challenge with many of the banks, how they're going to really analyze these and help us. Of course, the local government's insurance system is always there, but this new concept of weather-based system is a big challenge to us. So finally, if you look at strategic priorities for agriculture, looking into this whole triad of how do you promote rural livelihood development, looking at skills, social empowerment, looking at NRM systems of land, water, and biodiversity, and finally looking into the whole productivity system, bringing agriculture a more competitive mode with policies, water efficiency, and markets. So our theme is that the future, what we want to be is that how do you now create more income and jobs per drop of water? This is what the whole World Bank project is all about. And it is very clear that in democracy, it is clear that unless water and agriculture becomes everybody's business, as what Dr. Anil Agarwal said, it will continue to remain a source of conflict and contamination. And that is what we have all been seeing. So it is not just business as usual. We need to look beyond that. Many of us say we need to look at win-win situation, but I always looked at a will-win situation. I think as stakeholders, when we're all part of this whole business, I think we need to have first the willpower to really say that I can and we can do. I did like Mr. Gowda saying that we can do. He brought about a transformation of a chickpea in Andhra Pradesh. We can do, provided we have the will of how do we go about it. MS Swaminathan Foundation also promotes a major program, what is called Bio-Villages. So the watershed program, our information village programs, all these programs are finally today converged into a holistic program, what we call Bio-Villages. And today, that is what the mandate of the MS Swaminathan Foundation is, that to promote Bio-Villages across the country so that every village in the country becomes a Bio-Village, which does look at holistic, human-centered, sustainable development, where the health and happiness of the families is very important. When you say health and happiness, that is what we call as bio-happiness. Dr. Swaminathan has just released a book on bio-happiness. If you're interested, we'll be happy to give you a copy of the book. You can buy it, and it is also very low priced. So finally, we're looking into the whole empowerment process. It's just a photograph showing you that how an ordinary tribal woman in the remote areas of Odisha is today empowered to really lead her group of women towards an empowerment process. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hopper. Is there any questions or comments to this? No. Thank you. Thank you very much for the presentation. Our next speaker is Dr. A.K. Handa. He's the Principal Scientist, National Research Center for Agroforestry. Dr. Handa, please.
Thank you, Chairman, for providing me this opportunity to highlight the role of agroforestry in this platform, that agroforestry can also play an important role in increasing the agriculture productivity and sustainability in the country. As we know, that agroforestry has a very important role, and it has many achievements to its credit. And today I will discuss what we have achieved till date and what are the key issues in agroforestry sustainability and what are the future we are thinking about. Just we can say that agroforestry has a major role in sustainability due to the diversified role it plays in the Indian agriculture, particularly for the small farmers and the marginal farmers, due to the risk coverage provided by the agroforestry. And for examples, we have converted many marginal lands, like salt affected lands, can be converted into the productive lands with the help of plantations through agroforestry. Now those lands which are not producing even a single grass but are now cultivable lands through the role of agroforestry. Why we should adopt agroforestry? It is due to the economic growth, poverty alleviation, and environmental quality. Agroforestry provides security for livelihood, nutritional, energy, and environment. The agroforestry is being practiced in our country since ages, like home gardens and shifting cultivation and tongia system in the northeast. But agroforestry as a science has evolved very recently when we have taken care for the choice of the proper species, what should be its geometry, orientation, how the two components, tree and crop, interact with each other, and what should be the designs of the for a system. Now the agroforestry research in India is, India, since ever the organized research in agroforestry, India has been at the forefront. And in 1983, this Acripon agroforestry was initiated, and later on this NRC agroforestry was established. Now at present, there are more than 2,000 scientists and technicians engaged in agroforestry in the country. There are a lot of opportunities for agroforestry, like there are many development programs or schemes of the Government of India in which agroforestry is included in those schemes, and agroforestry has a role to convert these wastelands and make them renewable with the help of tree plantations. And one of the major contribution is in the economy of livelihood impact in terms of income and employment generation. We can see that agroforestry has a tremendous potential in employment generation through agroforestry systems. And one of the reports of Ministry of Environment says that agroforestry can give employment to the tune of 943 million persons a day per annum. The main issues in agroforestry research today is, first of all, is the quality planting material or tree improvement. As in the case of crop improvement, we have many programs in the crop plant breeding and other studies, but in case of forest, we have very little programs on tree improvement. Then for the livelihood security, the potential of agroforestry for carbon sequestration or mitigation, value addition through agroforestry. Agroforestry can play a major role in bioenergy and biofuels. Then there are issues of agroforestry policy and the national mission on agroforestry. Now, what agroforestry has contributed till date is that every 2 years, the Forest Survey of India brings out a report on the status of forests in our country. According to its latest report, the plantation area in India at present is 32.57 million hectares, which is second largest in the world after China. So all this plantation forest area is through agroforestry only, which is outside the forest. And when we consider the growing stock of forest, the tree outside forests are only one third to the growing stock of forest of the growing stock. And the annual requirement of the 80% of our annual requirement of wood is met nowadays through tree outside forest only. So this shows that agroforestry is meeting the main requirement for wood, and the mean annual increment of this plantation forest is much higher compared to our natural forest, which is only 0.5 cubic meter per hectare per year, whereas the these agroforestry plantations have the productivity of 10 to 60 cubic meter per hectare per year. At present in our country, there are about 23,000 sawmills and 95, so many units of using wood are there, but all the wood requirement for this is coming through agroforestry only, as there is a complete ban on felling the green wood in the forest. So all the wood requirement for this is met through agroforestry only. But still, we are importing wood from the other countries to the tune of 42,000 crores per annum, which is second largest import after the petro products. So we can say that if we promote agroforestry, we can save this much of foreign exchange by adopting the agroforestry in our marginal and small farmers only. Now, what is the current status of agroforestry research in our country is that through this agroforestry, this is one of the largest network project in the country with 37 centers throughout the country. And what we are doing in this project is, first we have to find out what is the current to design and diagnostic survey that how farmers, what are their requirements and what they want in species they are requiring. So it develops a basic information for developing the suitable agroforestry systems for any region. So some of the surveys have shown that for different regions of the country, like in Himalayan region, what are the land use practices for agroforestry for the different, based on the different altitudes from lower to higher. So in lower altitudes, they are preferring agri-horticulture systems. As we move upward, the silvipasture systems required for the fodder requirement of the farmers, they are adopting these fodder-based systems. Similarly, in the tropical regions, different species like casuarina, teak, coconut are being planted by the farmers for different agroforestry practices. For humid regions, these bamboo and Malina arborea, these are the species which are being adopted by the farmers. Now coming to one of the most important issue in agroforestry is availability of the quality planting material. At present, the quality fast growing seedlings are not available, and the farmers have to plant whatever the material is available. There is no control over the private nurseries, and there is no mechanism to regulate the supply. At present, there is no mechanism to release a variety in the trees as in the case of plants and other horticulture crops. So whatever planting material is available in the private nurseries, the farmers are adopting that material, are planting that material. Just in this project till date, we have identified a number of species have been collected by the centers, and they are working on their genetic improvement. So at present, we are having this collection of 184 species in the country, out of which 20 most important species have been identified for the country, which can be adopted for different agroclimatic regions. Just like most of the most important species which are suitable for throughout the country, like poplar, dalbergia, these are some of the species in which best germplasm have been identified, and hybrids have also been evolved, and these some clones have been developed for these species. Similarly, the clonal seed orchards have also been established for some species, and work is going on its improvement. This type of variability is existing in the nature for different species. Just for the example, in neem seed, which is very important for its pesticide properties, there is so much variability in the nature for its seed characteristics. So we have to explore this type of variability, like neem trees. For agroforestry, we have to go for the compact crowns and straight bole trees, which can be used under the agroforestry system. So all these variabilities are available in the nature, but we have to exploit them and use for the maximum to maximize the productivity. This type of varieties in the one of the species, Shimaruba, important biofuel species, this type of variability is existing. So our ultimate aim is to identify and this type of trees, like this is a shisham tree, germplasm has been identified, which is very straight compared to the control, and these can have the maximum productivity, such type of. Then we have identified different agroforestry systems for the different regions, for the Himalayan, Indo-Gangetic, semi-arid regions, tropical and humid region, and all this information is available on this website of our center, which is having this database on the agroforestry research in the country. So these are the some of the systems which we have developed. Like in Himalayan region, the fodder is an important factor. So species like which are producing tree fodder, like Gravia, Morus, are the most preferred species along with other horticulture and other crops. For the Indo-Gangetic plains, poplar, this is the most preferred species in agroforestry system, which has revolutionized the agroforestry adoption in the country due to the linkage with the industry. You can see the economics of the different this poplar based system, that when we are adopting this planting this poplar, the returns are much higher compared to the when we are using only crops are we are growing. Similarly, eucalyptus based system have been developed, which is very economical for the different for the Indo-Gangetic regions. Particularly, its productivity of the clonal material is much higher compared to the natural seedlings. And if we can replace this 3.5 million hectare of eucalyptus, is even 50% is replaced by this clonal material, then 6.39 million cubic meter can be the additional biomass can be produced. Similarly, for arid and semi-arid regions, these are the shelter belt system have been developed by the important species. For arid and semi-arid regions, the moisture is the most important factor, and we have to develop, identify such type of species which crown, or the species whose crown can minimum competition with the crops, and the intercrops are not affected. These are another beneficial, economically beneficial system in semi-arid regions. The fodder is the most important requirement of the semi-arid regions, and these systems for the silvipasture system have been developed. Economics is an important factor for adopting any system. For this type prosopis in area based system, the economics is given for an example with the BC ratio is higher, 1.65, and the internal rate of return is higher. Similarly, for the humid and semi-humid regions also, these bamboo-based and melina are the most important species. And Acacia nilotica is also being adopted by the farmers in this region. Horticulture system is very important for these tropical regions, where this 3-layer system like in which we can Lucina, sorghum, and Stylosanthus provide the fodder to the farmers throughout the year. In this system, you can say that in Andhra Pradesh, the Lucina is being adopted by farmers in three ways. We can say that third category of the farmers, which are earning the maximum BC ratio, and now the other farmers who are planting subulbul only for pulpwood or with intercrops are now changing to this third type of the group where animal husbandry is also included in this. These are also some of the systems for these tropical regions. Now, agroforestry can also play an important role in the biofuels. Nowadays we are knowing that we are importing a lot of petro products, but agroforestry through this bioenergy and biofuel can help in this bioenergy by developing the high yielding varieties and standardizing their technology and value addition for economic returns and complete chain from production to consumption. Most important is this biofuel is Jatropha, for which work is going on for its hybridization and multi-location trials. Similarly, for the Pongamia, in which there is a lot of variation is there, and we have to identify the best germplasm and hybridization program how to develop. Similarly, bioenergy through use of biomass through gasifiers, like this species which are not treated earlier as weed only, like prosopis, they can be a major source for the boilers in power generation, like from this production to this utilization through this bio for energy. Similarly, agroforestry can play a major role in carbon sequestration also. We are working on these different models to identify the potential of different systems of agroforestry in the carbon sequestration. Similarly, agroforestry can help in the employment generation through different industrial tie-ups. So these are the value additions can be helped through this. For example, I'll show that in this cricket bat industry. Salix is the used for the cricket bat, but the farmers told and the industry told that for this, they need only the female plants of salix. We are not knowing earlier this thing that for the bat produced from female plants of salix is much better as compared to but in nature, the male population of salix is much higher. So we are now working on this to increase the population of this female salix plants. Similarly, these small cottage industries are being helped through agroforestry. Other applications like apiculture and mushroom production with the help of agroforestry can be. So now coming to what are the key policy issues affecting the adoption of agroforestry. The major area which is affecting is that there is no independent agroforestry policy. We are having policy for agriculture and for forest, but there is no policy for agroforestry. And there is very need for the independent policy for the agroforestry, and the farmers adopting agroforestry are not getting any credit and for adopting the agroforestry, and no insurance is for the agroforestry product is there. Moreover, the agroforestry products, they are very long rotation is there, and I have already told that quality seed planting material is the major problem. When we compare the agriculture produce and tree marketing, there is vast infrastructure of the state government for agriculture produce, but there is such privileges are not available for the tree marketing. And it is dominated by the bureaucratic regulations. There are forest laws through which the farmer producing his produce cannot sell his produce to the other, cannot move his produce to other states. Just now we heard that in chickpea, the farmers are moving their produce from Andhra Pradesh to other states. But in case of wood produced by the farmer, he cannot move it out from his own state to other state due to the regulations of forest law. So there is urgent need to the barriers which are hindering the agroforestry adoption to be removed, and there is a need for this. Another important issue is public-private sector linkages. Like some of the key success issues are like WIMCO, which has resulted in the large-scale adoption of popular programs. ITC Bhadrachalam has helped in the eucalyptus and casuarina. Similarly, Westcote paper mill And the productivity of these material developed by these companies is much higher compared to the seedling material. So some of the successful models have also been developed, like the National Tree Grower Cooperatives, Indian Farm Forestry Development Cooperatives, and Dr. Hegde is present here. His NGO BAF has done a wonderful work on this promotion of agroforestry in the country. Now coming to the way forward for agroforestry, one of the most important is PPP in commercialization of agroforestry technology. And we have to develop the networks for transferring proven technologies to the farmers and explore the unexploited and underexploited species for higher economic value, such as medicinal, aromatic, and oil yielding. And there is a policy on the interstate transport of agroforestry needs to be liberalized and ensure the quality planting material and no free distribution of the material. Until and unless we are giving free planting material, they are not caring for its growth. So we have to stop this free distribution of the materials. New initiatives, what we have taken is a new network project on fodder tree improvement is being initiated. And there is a steps have been taken toward the National Mission on Agroforestry. But we have to link this with the another national missions on like livelihood security, National Bamboo Mission, Biofuel Mission, and Medicinal and Aromatic Mission, and Greening India Mission, which says that we have to cover in the next 10 years about 1 billion hectare of the country with tree cover. And it can be achieved only with the help of agroforestry only. Thank you for this.
Thank you, Dr. Handa. Any questions and comments to, yeah.
A nice presentation and a lot of information and knowledge. Couple of comments, not necessarily towards the presentation, but in general. So there is a constant dealing between R&D, which means research and development, to the consumer. Here, if the consumer is farmer, and we want increasing agriculture productivity and sustainability, the future we want. With such amount of tremendous good work being done. Do you see a research institute's role or mandate being expanded to reach the consumer or the farmer with the knowledge they have generated and produced and validated? That's one. Second thing is, I always feel that we underestimate the potential of the human capital which we have. We want the farmers to farm, but we don't want to support them to farm. So if we don't leverage the human capital we have, neither food security, nor income security, nor nutritional security, nor ecological security will not be met. So we need to leverage on the human capital. Therefore, the PPP need not necessarily only be an industry, be a private partner. It could also be CBOs or civil society organizations who can be one of the piece. So that it's a people-driven organization which will carry the movement. So these are the three things. And I want your quick reaction as a scientist of eminence. How do you feel some of these things, solutions in your bag, not being used by some of the farmers for the welfare of the country?
So, one of the major reason I told that farmers are not adopting these technologies developed is until and unless we will liberalize this agroforestry produced from the bureaucratic hold, that the movement, what farmer wants to produce, he should be free to sell it also. For example, in Punjab, earlier the farmers are getting about 1,100 rupees per ton for the poplar wood when they are selling it in the Haryana. But in the last year, the government of the Punjab has restricted its movement to sell it to Haryana. It is compulsory now to sell it for the farmer to in Punjab only, and they are getting only 700 rupees. So they are losing 400 rupees per ton. So until and unless we will move for this liberalized movement, as in the agriculture produced or horticulture produced, until and unless we will not liberalize this agroforestry produced from these hurdles, we will, whatever success we will achieve in our research, we will not be able to go to the farmers will not adopt it.
Thank you. I think, one more question, just quick.
In the context of the enlightening lecture, I have one question. While you mentioned about the relevance of agroforestry in the reclamation of calcareous wasteland and carbon sequestration from the soils, I wanted to know, is there any likelihood of agroforestry and species grown therein being used as a tool of phytoremediation in order to take up toxic metals, pesticide residues and so on, which could affect much of the crop plants, leading to biomagnification and such. Has there been any such work done? And I'd like to know.
Yes, some work has been done on the
species for the salt affected soils, where the prosopis and acacia have converted the wastelands which are not producing anything with higher pH. Alkaline soils were there in Karnal area. Now they have been, after 10 to 12 years of the plantation, and once these trees are harvested, those soils are converted into the cultivable lands, and now they are being.
For heavy metals also some species are there.
There are, I think we'll leave it there because we have one more presentation with us. But I have just a quick comment to make. Why you are ignoring the coastal area? You have a long coastline of 7,500 kilometers.
Yeah. I think that is one area. For coastal area, some species like casuarina, some clones have been developed.
No, but your agroforestry model did not.
Models have also been developed for casuarina.
That is one. The second one is, I think we need to move into the carbon trading economy.
Yeah.
And that one area which we can look in the future, because so much of agroforestry systems when we develop, then I think we can get some benefits from the carbon trading. And these are the small things you can take into account. Anyway, thank you for your nice presentation. Our last speaker of the today is, this session, is Dr. Anill Joshi. He's a well-known figure, he's a mountain man, and he has a lot of experience with working with the farming community. Just now he has come back from a long cycle yatra, which he made for, I think, almost about 3,000 kilometer cycle yatra.
Namaskar. I have come from the mountains, and I just want to quote a couple of farmers' expressions. As Ajay has pointed out, that I have recently been in a cycle march for 2,200 kilometers from West Bengal to Uttarakhand, ended on 24th of December, and then we had earlier in 2008, 4,500 kilometers from Kanyakumari to Kashmir. To know the India, the rural India, the true India. And I'm going to quote, because Dr. Sethi asked me to speak on youth and the future agriculture. So I am to tell you that Arjun Singh of village Adharpur, Khagadia, Bihar, Ram Naresh, another youth from the another village of the Bihar, and so many Ram Naresh and Arjun, they denied outright that we are not going to do the agriculture in future. We won't go for the agriculture. I am requesting my father to sell a piece of land that he holds, pay my capitation fee, and I'll do some engineering or doctor and whatnot. And even if I don't get it, I'll do anything damn I get in the urbans. I'll not live in the village. So if it is going to happen, and so was the story of 98.2% youth that we interviewed when we were traveling for Kanyakumari to Kashmir, all denied that we won't do the agriculture. If this is going to happen, what is going to be the fate of agriculture in the country after 20 years? We are going to be the youngest country in the world. And this is what youth opinion was in the country. Now the question is that how can we deny three, four important things? Number one, can any of us live without a food 3 months? Can any one of us live without a water 3 days? And without an oxygen, the pranavayu that we call, 3 minutes off. But unfortunately, we have not been seriously thinking the factors supporting the agriculture itself, because I don't see this should be called agriculture anymore. It's agri-commerce, culture gone. Because there is no culture at all. It's everything commerce. We look into the farm productivity, we look into the population that we have to feed, and then we have to be more productive, and at the name of that we have lost a lot. Why I'm saying so? If the factors supporting agriculture, the human lives. We cannot live without food. We cannot live without the air, without the oxygen. We cannot live without the water. What is the status of these sub factors in the country? Have we ever been thinking? We talk of GDP, GDP, GDP. We're fed up with this GDP. Whose GDP is this? When there was an independence, at the time, we were the true agriculture country. I remember I used to read when I was a student, Ye Krishi Pradhan Desh Hai. I know many of you must be knowing, Ghag was one poet in our country. He used to say that the worst thing is the business and the best thing is the farming. It was a long time ago, the Ghag said, Uttam Kheti Madhyam Ban Neech Chakiri Bhik Saman. Somebody must be knowing that the worst thing was the service that you do in the anywhere, that is the worst kind of a people's status, and the best is said to be was the farming. But today everything is different. It is in a Madhyam Chakri Uttam Ban Neech Kisani Bhik Saman. That means best is the business, second important is the service, and the worst is the farming, which is like begging. This is what Ghag said and what is happening today. Now the question is, have we ever thought that the kind of productivity we are expecting from the farmers, what is his status? You see, the single factor which denied them to do a farming in the future, and you see, when we were traveling, we had a lot of pain, of course, doing a cycling, but we forgot the pain, because out of 1800 villages that we and 10,000 people we met, none of us happy, which was the true India's expression. And now we should decide where the India is going. Is the India Delhi, Dehradun, Bangalore? Is the India truly live in the villages? And the villages govern the farming, villages govern the forest, the river, and everything they are governed, which we rather enjoy and take advantage. We do not know. We know the water comes from the tap. We do not know where the water comes from. The forest, the villages, they form the water, and the soil are the product of the forest. See, unfortunately, currently the GDP we are measuring, the growth measure in this country, absolutely ignore the factor supporting the life. That is the water. Do we have any growth measure in this country which say, if this is the economic growth, what is the ecological growth? We do not have any single factor to decide that. And that has been the reason why the farmers say, many farmers quote, I am trying to quote you here, our farming is bribing today. It does not speak unless it is given a fertilizer chemical. We do not take that much of medicine for our family as much as the insecticide and pesticide we have to use for our crops. The total cost of the input has gone many high. So what is the benefit, advantage a farmer going to have, you know, the structure? It is the middleman. Unfortunately, the farmers produce the wheat and Shakti Bhot Annapurna Wala sell the flour. Why could we not decentralize ourselves? We produce the apple, the Kisan fellow makes the jam and jelly, the larger profit goes to him. We produce A, B class of the apple, but the Reliance and the other retail people coming takes the more and more benefits. And that is one reason why youth deny that we do not need anything at the name of the agriculture. And if this is going to be, so we must know the fact that youths are here also. The question is that the kind of agriculture, the farming, because agriculture is not only agriculture. It was called agriculture because it was inclusive of soil, inclusive of the forest. Everything inclusive was an agriculture. That was truly called agriculture. That was to be defined as agriculture. But today we have a different route taken for that. Now the question of youth not being interested in coming, you know, these are the some of the facts of the youth. They are the largest population likely to come in this country. And 80% rural youth have migration tendency. They don't want to live in the village. They want to see anything we get in the urban will move. And 25% are prone to anti-social activities. You know, the terrorism, Naxal and Maoist coming. It is basically because of uneconomic activities that they don't enjoy in the places they are born. Now, question is, as I said, the farmer said, now these are what they say, non-profitable activity. They say when BMW and most car making people take only one time loan and they survive rest of the life, why farmer had to take the loan every year? Because it's not profitable. What is it? The car fellow make a car and dictate his price, but what farmers produce, his price is dictated by someone else. He said this is the reason why we never want to do. And then above all, the climate, Mars, unpredictable climate, that has, because we do not have anything. If the crop fails, there is no one to stand by. Ultimately, we hang ourselves. That is was what broad opinion of the farmer was. And as I said, reduced somehow input cost, which the farmer had been saying. And the most important was, which I want to, draw your attention, is if there is a ray of hope, there is a silver line somewhere. Some of the youth that we came across and met, and some of the models which we have been talking last 2 days, I think we better should learn from the people doing something in the very remote, very isolated place. They can be the best model which we can applicate. Because the kind of model that we suggest, there are so many parameters that we have to look into. But here in the village, if any experiment is there, which is taken up by some youth, in wanting, there is no employment opportunity elsewhere, he begins his own experiment, is the most important. To us, the important issue is that currently, as youth deny, the only way out is that whether, as has been said by an MSSR, Hopper has shown a very good presentation that how local community involved in ecological employment opportunities to the resource-based economy. That's the only answer that we must see. And as I said, there are some innovative way of doing the farming and the market. I know the many people say, where is the market? Where is not a market? Rural India is flooded with the product made in by the urban, and whole resources are transported from rural to urban. Who says there is no market? Rural India is flooded. 82% product that we saw in the local shop being sold made in the urban, and 72 were local resource based, because they are transported, they are produced, and then they come in the village as they are the biggest market that we have. So I personally have a feeling that the kind of initiative that had been taken are good example, taking an example of Himalayan people. They had many, many temples. And unfortunately, we have been major crops are millets. There are two crops you must be knowing, Amaranthus cholai that we call, and another was a buckwheat kuttu. Now these two crops, whenever we keep a fast, we have been eating them because the God say you can eat them, rest of not. These are the two. But unfortunately, we have Badrinath, Kedarnath, Vaishno Devi, the great temples, but they never entertained this as an offering. They said, no, this is not. What we tried that, we put a pressure on these temple committee and said that you should accept this as a prasad, because by encouraging these as a prasad, meaning by encouraging the local crop. And we begin with that, this. And these are the temples currently are doing this, and some local crops that we have. And this is Vaishno Devi. Vaishno Devi, we begin with that, they produce the maize, corn. There is no market available. Today, some Parthal village is a village where the youth and the women have been making laddu, the sweet balls out of the corn, and their turnover is 44 lakh rupees, 4.4. This is an innovative market approach that the community had. Now, similarly, the many other temples that they had after. Now, tell me a single shop where the biscuits are not sold in the villages. Why not? When we produce wheat, we produce the kind of a millet which we call a nutri millet. Why can't we make the bakery products out of it? You can go to the better market also. So this way, some women have earned, some youth have earned. And similarly, once there was a demand for baking, the crop cultivation size increased. This is one project which we are doing with the MSSRF also. Now in horticulture, we are richest in horticulture. Unfortunately, most of our produce go away. Transportation, and we are the richest also, you can consider, because in the lack of market, we feed our cattle with the apple. No transportation. So in that case, this is irony that, but some women have come forward to make some products. These are the innovative, their fruit bars, they have been making fruit products, they have been making remote in villages, you'll find the fruit process units operating, because these are related agro-based industries. That is the one possibility. And once they are there, once we know where we can sell it locally, we have the crop or the horticulture area that we can increase, like Maggie kind of noodles and selling it to the local markets. These are, he found himself this opportunity and worked on that. Similarly, we met someone in the West Bengal again. This guy has a lot of paddy growing, but he made his own product by saying India Gate, product of rice paddy that we produce. Now this is kind of paddy that he has been doing. So these are, he found this and then he did not hesitate to work in the crop his father had given him the notions to do so. So there, that is one ray hope where we can involve the youth, because what farmers currently producing, until and unless there is a value addition, we cannot do it. We cannot do it. Youth to be involved only once they find that it is an paying, attractive, and they also want to become a sahab. Like the urban friends of there have been using a mobile and motorcycle, they equally deserve to do so, because they are the ultimately most important. And there are then one very important example. Unfortunately, when we were country crossing, see, 80% household were using the cow dung as a fuel, but no IITs, no NITs, they have never developed any device to make this. Because every woman had been doing all day this, but where is this country, modern atomic power, nuclear power, and what not kind of power? Do we have a single device which can produce these? And this has been a major source of fuel in this country. It has to be more efficient. And I'm to tell you that, interestingly, the one guy who had been doing this business for the last 7 years, 7-8 years, earning 10 to 12,000 rupees per month out of this simple collecting the cow dung cake and selling the dung cake and selling to the other plant. And when we found how many are they, they said there are 100 around in the district are doing this business. But unfortunately, we have not been able to do so. When we were near to Banaras, Varanasi, we met these BA pass youth were selling the flower and the garlands. Now, when we asked why it is, they said what we had been producing earlier, there is no water scarcity. We promote the water, I mean the flour, and we make this, but our problem stands one. What we ask, what is your problem? Normally, we fail to sell every day so many garlands that we make, but the women are also involved in that. It's an inclusive kind of an approach. But the next day, we do not have any technology which we can preserve them. Unfortunately, there was not a single one. And also, if even 3 days, 4 days after, we do not have any technology which we can process it further from other value-added products. And there was one vegetable institute close to this place when we had gone to this. So now the question is, who decides the priority and how the priorities be defined? I think we really need to see the India and find the priorities area. Well, this is in the mountain. There is a, this is one piece of land where I appreciate this guy did not have, had not been doing, he had a small place where he just was harvesting the water, ecological employment opportunities, and was selling the water to the people around, and had a charge that way. And when I came to know, wanted to know from him, how many places you are doing so, there's some now many farmers failing to grow the agriculture, what they harvest, the monsoon, and then sell it water to the others. And then still other are putting a tube well, producing it and sharing it with other farmers. I think we really need ecological employment opportunity, because friends, we cannot currently, we are Krishi Pradhan, this is still 70% people live with the farming, but the farming as such as cannot be taken, it's inclusive. And when we talk of inclusive, we soon forget that the most important factors are water, which every farmer was saying the water and water crisis. And the second was the agriculture input, especially the fertilizer, and many, and the top of them was the market, because the prices they get is very, very low against the one who take advantage of their produce as a middleman. The question that the focus now should be on 2-3 issues, market skill and innovative marketing strategies, where we local youth be involved in the value addition and find a market locally. Otherwise, that city is overcrowded, no rural, no village. So you can think that what is going to be the future, we will become a population bomb, which will blast any day and it is begin to grow. You will agree that whether it is a Bangalore, Dehradun, other places, internal migration is very, very fast. because they do not find any opportunity locally. I think the strategy should revolve around that there must be ecological growth measure. When we say ecological growth measure, we demand we'll ensure good water, good forest, good soil in the villages, and they are the true economic growth measure for any given village. No GDP. And all of you must understand that the life depends on them, not in the ecology, not in the economic growth measure. Economic growth measure is for the urban and the luxury. Ecological growth measure for the life. You have to decide yourself what do you want in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Joshi. Any comments or any questions you would like to ask Dr. Joshi? No, I think everybody is hungry. Huh?
Convinced.
Yeah, just 1 minute, I think, yes. Yeah.
It's a wonderful presentation. I feel someday we are lacking the linkage. We have an excellent institute which can offer many solutions to the problem you have posed. Second thing is, there are a lot of youth. I think I have got at least 100 youth in the urban area and peri-urban areas. The kind of investment they make, particularly because they are from IT sectors, most of them are leaving IT jobs and going to the farming, making a small group, investing in crores. Hey, I'm not recommending that. What I'm saying is, a module like this, it can link with the persons of IT background or youth who are really and seriously interested in making a farming really a very good agri venture. Probably something can be done for future.
That's the, you know, rural-urban connectivity we need. The one who qualifies should be the part of the rural. Because if the rural will not stay back, and the one who has earned in the urban, both are going to be the victim in future. We must see. If the urban guy feel that he would get a water in the tap, no, it is not going to happen in the future. So urban-rural connectivity is, of course, rural producer, urban consumer, but the share of profit must be equal. It should not be like that the one who produces, the primary producer, should get more, and IT guys know well how to deal with the product and the brand gets more. No, it is what otherwise different in the Reliance and the Easy Day and others. What I know, couple of IT guys also, they had come to our place also. But the ultimate objective was there that we will be the farming part, and will you produce it, we will pay you this contract farming and we will sell it. No, we want a shareholding. What any enterprise that we take in the village, it would be based on the sharehold. That my produce, whatever you pay, sell it in, we should have a share. We definitely need rural-urban connectivity because both are one way, the producer and consumers.
I think you can discuss with...
No, sir, it may be relevant for the group, that's what I'm telling. Four youth, I'll give you two examples. For developed dairy farming, inclusive of 5,000 farmers. There are people who went in the horticulture, hardly 12 youths of IT background who have promoted more than 2,000 farmers. So what I am saying is this module can help not only for Karnataka.
I don't think an IT guy will be able to
mobilize the farmers. I mean, that's anybody, any of us can mobilize the farmers. I mean, what a IT guy brings in new innovation to the model. I mean,
there are. देखिए ऐसा है कई आईटी और ईआईटी और तमाम तरह के आईटी फैशन बतौर भी गांव में काम करना चाहते हैं तो मुझे लगता है कि सच्चाई अब फैशन में चली गई कुछ ऐसा भी काम होना चाहिए जहां ईमानदारी हो एंड दिस इज व्हाट वी हैव बीन लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू
जोशी एंड थैंक ऑल द फोर प्रेजेंटेशंस आई मीन दे मेड नाइस प्रेजेंटेशन आई विल ओनली रिक्वेस्ट ऑल ऑफ यू आई नो दैट ऑल ऑफ यू आर फीलिंग हंग्री सो कैन यू फिनिश योर लंच क्विकली सो दैट यू कैन रीअसेंबल एट 2:15 It's now 1:30, so you can take a lunch break for 45 minutes and reassemble at 2:15.